this next song, I just want you to take a moment. I remember I just got back from camp this summer, and I remember missing camp. I remember missing the ministry. Don't get me wrong, as I was at camp, there was a lot of trials because I was dealing with kids that were really young, and they didn't always listen. And so I was waiting for camp to get done. And then after camp was over, I missed being in that spiritual sense, being over the kids. And God was just dealing with me, and this song came on. And those words always struck me. It says, Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters wherever you will call me. And I knew in my heart that I had been running from what God wants. I was trying to do my own thing. I was trying to do what I wanted, and I was trying to justify the fact that that's what God wanted. But as those words hit me, I knew I couldn't really sing them without being kind of dishonest. And so I said, God, all right, I'm willing to surrender. I'm willing to give it to you. So if you've been running from God this morning and you want to sing those words truthfully, all you have to do is surrender this morning. So as we sing the song and it talks about that amazing faith, just ask for God to give you that amazing faith. If it takes you saying, God, I want to be where, if you have to say that in your mind as we're singing through that, I want to be at that point where my trust is without borders, then ask God for that. But worship in spirit and in truth this morning. Amen.
Thank you.
takes us. That takes us being faithful. It takes us taking God to the world. It doesn't have to be, but God chooses to use us. So as we sing this song, as you're saying, God's take me where your spirit, take me where trust is without borders, then we need to be willing to stand upon the rooftops and claim God's glory. Amen. Don't move by me, God, and what I'm doing, because, God, I take for granted those things. So, God, thank you for your presence being here. I pray that it would move. Just move amongst us, God. Hold us in your arms. Sing with me. Your presence is heaven to me.
Heaven to me.
Able to go to a smaller church actually, and the worship was great. The guy who was doing it was very talented. As we were playing, I have been reading in this MIP, I've been reading about the priests and all the different things that they would do in the Old Testament to worship God. And one of the things that they would do is when God would lift his hand of protection because of the sin, destruction would come. And as they would gather together, especially during Nehemiah's time when he came to rebuild the wall, not only did they rebuild the physical wall, but there was priests that came along, and their job was to draw the people together and to read the word of God and to recommit themselves. And as I was sitting there in worship, I don't always get to worship the same here because I'm always playing either the drums or the guitar. And it's been so long. And in a church where nobody knew me, I was really hesitant, but God was telling me, go be on your knees at the front before me. And I was like, I really want to, but God, I don't want to look stupid because I don't know anybody here. Maybe somebody will think that I think I'm super spiritual or something. And God was saying, okay. And I felt like he was saying, okay, you don't have to. I felt like he was saying, do you really want to give me a gift? Do you really want to worship me as they did in the old times when they were rededicating themselves? And I said, yes. And it took everything I had, but I walked up and I just got on my knees, and everybody else is kind of sitting back, relaxing during worship. And the pastor, I think it really blessed him, thankfully, because I didn't want it to seem weird, but like he just busted out in worship, and everybody was just, it just intensified things. But it wasn't even about that. It was about the fact that I said, God, I need to evaluate where I'm at, and am I willing to give you whatever you want? Am I willing to sit in front of you? And is this about you? And so as we do communion, challenge you to think about that. Is it about God? What are we willing to go? What length?
Amen. As we prepare for communion this morning, as Pastor Aaron said, we want to examine our hearts. This is the first time that many of us are taking it in the new year, the elements of the sacraments of the Lord's Supper. So we want to take it with a clean heart. We want to take it with faith, not just out of tradition and redundancy, out of a habit. We want to take it with faith today that God is able. The song that we just sang says, our God is able. Our God is stronger. There is no one that's higher than our God. And somebody needs to know that today. You need to sing that possessively. My God is greater. My God is stronger. My God is greater than any other. And if God is for you, who can be against you? That's scripture, right? If God is for you, and he is, who can be against you? So we're going to serve you communion. You may have your seats while we're serving. Please hold your elements until everyone is served, and then we will take communion together.
Open the eyes of the blind. There is no one like you.
viewers this morning, can y'all just kind of wave at them? Let them know that we're glad that they're here. As we transition for the kids to go to their ministry of this church, I'm going to ask you to do something that might seem a little bit strange. But how many know strange faith is good faith? If it makes sense, it's not faith, right? So what I'm going to ask you to do this morning is going to have to be an act of faith on your part and mine, even asking you to do it. But before we hear the word of God today, I would like you, please, in faith, to just go and touch every chair and thank God for bodies in these chairs. Chairs don't go to heaven, and chairs don't know Jesus. Chairs can't do the work of the ministry and cannot fulfill the great commission of Matthew 28:19 that says, go therefore into all of the earth. Everyone, proclaim, teach them, and help them carry on the mission of Jesus. Chairs can't do that. So in faith, I would like you to go and touch every chair and just say, thank you, God, for people in this house. Thank you, God, for people that love you and will become to know you. Thank you, God, for bringing people into this house to hear the news of Jesus Christ. And I just want you to do that in faith today, because a new year is a great time for new beginnings and new vision. And so this is putting your faith into action. Make sure you touch every chair, because every chair represents a life. Every chair represents a child. Every chair represents an elderly person that needs to go to heaven. So today, please exercise your faith in believing that God is going to fulfill his word in Acts 2 that says daily he added to the church in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. God, as we walk around this church, Lord, it's in faith that we are welcoming people into this house. God, it's in faith that we know that you're going to do a mighty work in people's lives. God, in faith, we know, God, that you are going to be on the throne of people's lives, and that, Father God, lives will be changed because of our walk of faith this morning. As we begin this new year, God, I thank you for increase. I thank you, God, for more faith. I thank you for more mercy, more grace, more knowledge, more wisdom. I thank you for more influence, Father God. I thank you for more of you. God, in John 3:30, you said, I will decrease that you will increase. And so, Father God, help us this day to expand our faith, God. Help us to put legs on our prayers and action in our faith, God, that you would be glorified. It begins in this house, Father God, and it continues throughout our city. I thank you, God, that as these young people see us walking in faith, God, they may go home and ask their parents about that. And God, I pray that you would help us to just say, that's what faith is, baby. That's what it is. It's putting action into your faith, because without faith, with no action is in vain. So I thank you, God, that as these have obeyed the request to walk in faith today, Lord, you're going to do it. Help us next week, or even on Wednesday when we see the seats beginning to fill up, God, help us to rejoice and say, that's my God who's able to do exceedingly and abundantly above all that we could ever ask or think, according to the faith that works in us. In the name of Jesus. Now, as you're walking back to your seat, can you just thank God for meeting your request today? It's your request. It's your faith. It's your prayer. Can you thank him? Yes. Yes. Chuck Swindoll says, why go to God and ask for bread if you don't bring a basket? So if you're going to ask, expect to receive, because you receive as you believe. And I pray that spurs you in your own life to put some legs on your faith and really believe God. I don't want another 12 months to go by, Jeanette, and we're in the same spot that we've been in for the last 12 months. Amen? We need faith to get us to where we need to be. Well, a new year is a great time to tell you, my church family, need to make sure I'm on point with this agenda that Pastor Aaron so faithfully does every Sunday. to tell you, my church family, and who are also my friends, that you are a continual source of great wonder and delight in my life and to my family. Together, we face the responsibilities of life and ministry arm in arm, on bended knee to bended knee, and sometimes with exuberance and other times with sorrow. We go together. The love, nurturing, and experiences we share is a gift of significance, and thank you is never enough to tell you how much I appreciate you. Stepping out of one year into a new year brings new possibilities, it brings new opportunities, and it also brings new goals. This time of year, the media reminds us of the biggest stories of the previous year, and they cover any and everything regarding people that is newsworthy in the past 12 months. What the media doesn't, however, cover is our own personal lives. And I want to invite you this morning, this first Sunday of the year of 2015, to take an assessment over your life. As you reflect over 2014, you will discover that God has been mighty, mighty good to you. As you recall the days that passed in the last 12 months, you will know that it was nobody but the Lord that brought you through those days and months. Nobody but God. For many, 2014 was a difficult year. It was a year of struggles, losses, and storms. It's been a strange year, bringing unique challenges and circumstances to deal with. And if you're like me, 2014 brought experiences that I had to walk through for the first time. But God, in the midst of our struggles, God in the midst of our storms, God in the midst of everything that we've been through, has kept us. God has kept us. God has kept us in our health. He's kept us in our finances. He made a way out of no way, and he stepped in right on time. Amen. To the glory of God, it's also been a year of accomplishments. Some went back to school. Some continued in school. Some moved into new homes. Some traded up for newer cars or updated cars. 2014 meant a year of job promotions for some, and others were promoted with better jobs. Some welcomed new babies, and some exchanged wedding vows, even in this church. New acquaintances were made in the year of 2014, and new experiences were afforded. Through it all, the good, the bad, and the indifferent, God is still God. And when others around you fell, God kept you and your family safe. Tell the truth and shame the devil. God kept you. So you're here today, this first Sunday in 2015, because God has allowed it. Andre Crouch, one of my favorite songwriters, who's getting really seasoned in his age. I look at him and don't remember him to be this old, but he wrote this song so many years ago, and maybe you know it. The lyrics say, I thank God for the mountains, and I thank him for the valleys. I thank him for the storms he brought me through. For if I never had a problem, I wouldn't know God could solve them. I'd never know what faith in God could do. Through it all, I've learned to trust in Jesus. I've learned to trust in God. Through it all, I've learned to depend upon his word. Anyone in here grateful this morning that through it all, you've learned, or you're learning, or you should have learned to trust in God and depend upon his word? Well, it's no secret, family, that the kind of world in which we live in today is drastically different from the world of our parents and even our grandparents. It's no secret that our kids deal with pressures that we never had to deal with. And that's the truth. This world is taking on a world personality all of its own. The Earth's population has exploded into every area of our planet, and we are able to see a God at work in many places of the world like never before because of technology and advancement. And yet it appears that sin and the love of this world is overtaking the remnants of the church. I'm reminded this morning of Romans 12:21 that says, "Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good." So there are some questions this morning that we as a church must seek God for as we transition out of 2014 and into 2015. As a church, what decisions need to be made to position our church to effectively and faithfully fulfill its call? Questions like, what priorities must we embrace to attract the hopes and dreams of a new generation of believers? With all due respect, we have young people in this church, and I'm so grateful because God answers prayer. There was a time not so long ago that there were no young people in this church under the age of 50 or 60. They would be here for a minute and then they'd be gone, but there was no consistent presence of young people in this church not so very long ago. God answers prayer. We have babies born every year in this church, I think, since I've been here at least. That's a good thing. That means new life. That means a younger generation. But at the same time, we're letting some of them slip through the cracks. Kids come in and they're bored. They talk to each other. They text each other. They want to go here. They want to run here. They want to go to the coffee house. And in the meantime, they're missing Jesus. That's the biggest thing. So the church is here to establish what's already happening in the home. If the home isn't being exposed to Jesus, the church can't pick up where the home isn't fulfilling its purpose. But we are to work together to show these young people, because it's not about us. It's about furthering the gospel, because one day you and I will not stand here. If we cannot pass the baton of ministry to these young people and train them at their little age of Thai and Christian, how in the world will the church carry on? I watched little Thai, and as soon as that music started today, he was reaching for the flag. He knows that's his weapon over here. He doesn't understand it, but it's because his mama has been praying for him since he was even conceived in her womb, that he would be a warrior, that he would be one who worships. And so when he was old enough to hold something, she put a flag in his hand. He doesn't understand it yet, but his spirit understands it. That when I hear music in this place, I'm to grab this flag and whip it around. And pretty soon she'll begin to teach him that that's weapons of warfare. That is your arsenal. Red represents the blood of Christ. White represents the holiness and the purity of Christ. Purple represents the majesty of Christ. And he will begin to understand what it means to wave that flag that once he just thought was a toy. How will they know if we don't teach them? How will they know that they are to reverence God and to interchange with God and to have him in their lives if we don't teach them, if we allow them to stay home, if we allow them to stay away from Bible study, if we allow them to stay away from prayer meetings? How will they learn? Because one thing is for sure, if we don't teach them, church, the world will teach them. Lady Gaga will teach them, and Drake, and Usher, and who else does my son try to listen to on a daily basis? Thinking he knows all those lyrics to those raps, I said, tell me Psalm 23, verse 1. Okay, turn it off. Because unjust scales is an abomination to the Lord, and I'm not here to preach fire and brimstone, but I'm here to teach the truth of God. If we as a church don't step up in who we are with God, our kids are going to get lost to the devil and the world. So I covet my son's innocence. I covet it. My daughter says, Mama, he's 11. He needs to know that there really are blah, blah, blah in the world. I said, you're right. He does need to know that. But until I think it's appropriate an age for him to know, he's going to be in the church. He's going to be in this church, if I have any control over it, or a church, learning about the things of God, knowing what it's like to sacrifice. You got money for Christmas, how much you tithing? But Mama, no, how much you tithing? The Lord giveth and the Lord taketh away. Everything belongs to him. So I pray this year we will get serious about our relationship with Jesus, so that our kids who watch us will get serious about their relationship with Jesus. As a church, what priorities must we embrace to attract the hopes and dreams of this new generation of believers? I don't want the young people to come in here and be bored. But if we don't come to church with exuberance, how are they going to come to church with exuberance? If we can't worship God, how are they going to worship God? So what do we need to change as a church? What do we need to cultivate in this church to attract this generation that is so media-driven and so socially wanting to be accepted? How do we get Jesus into them so that this is their church and not their parents' church? I don't have the answer. I have part of the answer, and you have part of the answer, and you have part of the answer, and these young people have part of the answer. So let's get it together. We also need to ask, what will it take to implement a push for us to grow the kingdom of God and make disciples? We also need to ask, what are the non-negotiables that we're willing to die for? I'm not willing to die for the paint color of the sanctuary or the outside of the building. I'm not willing to die for that. I don't care really what color it is. I have a preference. But that doesn't matter to me. You know what matters to me? Is what are we doing for Christ? And if we have trouble and time to complain about what's not going on in the church, we have trouble and time to pray for what isn't going right in the church. I'm not willing to die for those things that are liquid, fluid. But I am willing to die that we proclaim Jesus as Lord in this house. I am willing to proclaim that there is no other word but the word of God. So there are some things that are non-negotiables in this house that we must cleave to in this era of new generation, new thinking. Well, there's many ways to God. No, there's not. There's but one way to the Father. So we have to be willing to know what we're going to stand for and what we're not going to care about, really, as long as the work of the ministry is going forth. In this year 2015, we're moving from invisible to visible. God gave that to me probably 2 or 3 months ago, sitting in my office with the leaders of this church, and it just came up in a conversation, and God seared it in my spirit, from invisible to visible. And I said, that's going to be the kickoff for our new year. And I didn't know how it was going to come around, but I kept that thing in my prayer cloth, and I kept that thing in my spirit, and I said, God, you're going to have to show us what all that means. And I saw a quote on Facebook recently that said this: every day, people are straying away from the church and going back to God. Every day, people are straying away from the church and going back to God. Now, that seems like an oxymoron, doesn't it? Because how do you separate God from his church? I own a book with this title. I rearranged my library just yesterday, and I found this book again. And the title of this book is Love God, Hate the Church. Universally speaking, the mentality of people, both the churched and the unchurched, regardless of the age, regardless of the gender, regardless of their economic status and education achievement, universally speaking, the mentality of people regarding the church is sad to me. Somewhere along the line, the church has lost its importance and necessity in our culture. Apparently, no longer the church or its mission is relative to people's lives. Ask me how I know that. Look around. Do you see more seats or more people? There are people that belong to this church that don't think it's important enough to come to this church. They're in bed today. They're doing chores. They're out playing golf. Not really, probably on their Wii. They're out skiing. They're sleeping. They're doing whatever they need to do. Because church has lost its importance in people's lives. It's no longer a necessity. It doesn't matter if I go to church on this Sunday or any Sunday, because I'm going to get up and I'm going to go to my job on Monday. Don't ask me to miss my job on Monday. But I don't care if I go to church or not. I tell people all the time, come to church. You ask God to go with you every day of your week. On Sunday, you ask God, Saturday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, you say, God, be with me on my job. Be with me here. Be with me here. I'm traveling. Be with me. Give me travel mercy journeys. But one day a week, you should be able to come into his house. But we don't, because it's not important. Universally speaking, the church has lost its appeal. Somewhere along history's path, the church has failed, misrepresented, and misconstrued its mission in people's lives, enough to the point that people don't care whether they come to church or not. It's not important to them. And if it's not important to them, how can the people in the rest of the house feel like it's important? How can the people on your job feel like it's important? How can the people around you in your community feel like it's important when it's not important to you? And I know I'm preaching to the choir because you're all here today. But there are some people that are going to see this video that are not going to be in church. So, as I have pondered the effectiveness of our church in our city over the past almost 10 years, it's always been a thorn in my side that we remain small in numbers and in mission. For truly, we know the effectiveness of our church is affected by our physical numbers. And I'm going to demonstrate that to you in just a little while. I'm going to ask you to stay after church today and help tear down and undecorate Christmas. Because we do this, if you've been here more than one Christmas, you know we do this after the first Sunday of every year. We undecorate the Christmas. And two people are getting the job done. Four people are getting the job done faster. Six people got the job done. And 10 people, what job? So our effectiveness is directly related to the number of people that are on board. For true